ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः. इन द लास्ट रीडिंग क्लास ऑफ दिस बुक श्री रामकृष्ण द ग्रेट मास्टर द फर्स्ट फोर इयर्स ऑफ साधना वी वर रीडिंग एट पेज 236. We shall continue our reading from the same page. Surendranath Mitra, whom the master sometimes called Suresh Mitra, was celebrating the Durga Puja that year in his residence at Shimla. Shimla here means not the Shimla of Uttarakhand, but Himachal Pradesh. The Shimla is Simulia. What is called Simulia in Bengali, translated into English as Shimla. It is mistaken. Actually, it is Shimla is Simulia of Calcutta. It is a locality there. He was celebrating the Durga Puja that year in his residence at Shimla. Formerly, his family used to celebrate it every year, but there had once been a mishap and the worship had been discontinued since then. No one in the household was bold enough to perform it after that, because after the mishap, people thought that perhaps the mother does not want the puja. That way nobody wanted to start it again. And if anyone tried to celebrate it, all others dissuaded him vehemently. However, by his faith in the power of the master, Sri Ramakrishna, Surendranath was absolutely free from fear of any mishap due to the interference of demigods, etc., and did not care at all for anybody's objections or obstructions when he had once resolved to accomplish anything. Therefore, although all the members of the household raised objections, they could not make him refrain from carrying out his resolve that year. He got the master's approval and brought the mother of the universe in her image to his house and bore all the expenses himself, to the exclusion of other members of the joint family. The only element of sadness in Surendra's joy was that the master would not be able to join the celebrations on account of his illness. Again, as a few relatives fell seriously ill a few days before the commencement of the worship, he was held responsible for all that and incurred the displeasure of all the household. But unperturbed even on that account, Surendra devoutly began the worship of the Divine Mother with great care and attention and invited all his fellow disciples. This is how what the faith works. If you have real faith and in a really good person, so you get rid of all other fears. All the fears will go. Because when faith is there, when God is there, there is nothing untoward can happen. That also that faith comes. That is how people become fearless through devotion, through real faith. The worship pertaining to the seventh day of the lunar month, Saptami, had been finished the day before. It was the auspicious eighth day, Ashtami. Many devotees gathered together at the temporary residence of the master at Shyampukur and were enjoying in his company the bliss and talks and songs about the divine. Narendranath began singing devotional songs immediately after the doctor's arrival at 4 in the afternoon at Shyampukur. All were charmed by those exceedingly melodious vibrations of tunes coupled with remarkable spiritual fervor, and lost themselves completely in them. The master was sometimes having ecstasy, at the end of which he was explaining briefly in a low voice the import of the songs. to the doctor who sat beside him. Some of the devotees lost consciousness in deep spiritual emotion. There followed in the room a strong current of bliss, which was almost palpable. Time passed unbeknown to all, and it was 7:30 p.m. The doctor was startled at last. He embraced the Swami with paternal affection. The Swami was just hardly 19, 20 years at the time. And then the doctor was past 60 or 65, like a grandfather to him, or father, old father to him. So he embraced him out of joy. The doctor was embraced the Swami with paternal affection, took leave of the master and stood up. When the master also rose from his seat smiling and entered immediately into deep samadhi. The devotees began whispering, "Is it not the time for Sandhi Puja?" Sandhi Puja is the most important puja on the Ashtami day. So is it Ashtami Navami day? Sandhi is the conjunction of the Ashtami and the Navami. So in 24 minutes of Ashtami, 24 minutes of Navami, 48 minutes, there is a special puja called Sandhi Puja. That is a very important one. So the time for that, without knowing, Sri Ramakrishna did not have any watch with him, but he went into spiritual ecstasy. So the devotee started whispering, "Is it not the Sandhi Puja?" Even without knowing, the master is going into spiritual ecstasy. That is why the master has entered into samadhi. Is it a matter of little surprise that he has entered suddenly into it without knowing the time? About half an hour after, the master samadhi came to an end and the doctor bade good night. Doctor was about to go, he could not go without bidding farewell. And after half an hour only, he could bid farewell to the patient, that is Sri Ramakrishna. The master now said to the devotees about his samadhi, "I saw that there opened a luminous path from here to Surendra's house. I saw further that attracted by Surendra's devotion, the mother had appeared in the image and that a ray of light was coming out from her third eye. I also saw that rows of lamps were lighted in the front veranda and Surendra was sitting and weeping piteously in the courtyard in front of the mother. Go you all together to his house now. He will feel much comforted to see you." Sri Ramakrishna is telling them, without seeing, he is far away from that house. So he is describing whatever is happening there, as if you know he stayed seeing on the television. All, including Swami Vivekananda, then saluted the master and went to Surendra's place, which was not very far. They questioned him and came to know that rows of lamps were actually lighted in that veranda, and unable to check his surge of emotion, Surendra sat in the courtyard before the image and wept loudly like a boy, crying, "Mother, mother," for about an hour at the time of Master Samadhi. So exactly what Sri Ram described has happened there physically. Finding the vision during the Master Samadhi corresponding to the external events in detail, the devotees felt that there was no end to their joy and amazement. At one time, during the first 4 years of his sadhana, Rani Rasmani and Mathu Babu, her son-in-law, thought that the derangement of the master's brain produced by unbroken continence was manifesting itself as spiritual restlessness. This was their idea. Considering that he might regain his health if his continence were broken and desirous to do good to the master thereby, they tried to tempt him through Lakshmi Bai, a prostitute, and some other beautiful harlots with their amorous gestures, first at Dakshineshwar and afterwards in a house at Machua Bazaar in Calcutta. The master used to say that he saw the Divine Mother in those women, and repeating mother a few times lost consciousness of the world, and that his sense organ became contracted and entered completely into his body like the limbs of a tortoise. There arose, we were told, a feeling of maternal affection in the hearts of those fallen women, and when they saw all that, and they were charmed by the childlike behavior of the master, thinking that they had committed a great sin by trying to tempt him to break his continence, they begged his pardon with tears in their eyes, saluted him again and again, and bade goodbye with apprehensive minds. Fantastic conversion through holiness. See, there was no curse, there was no hard words hurled at them. Just by his presence, he could reform, he could bring in the real devotion to the hearts of these fallen women. Now we come to chapter 9, marriage and return to Dakshineshwar. The master's mother and brother were very anxious at Kamarpukur. All this was happening in Calcutta, about 100 kilometers away from Kamarpukur. So the mother and father, mother and his brother, they were feeling anxious on some other account. Hearing the news that Sri Ramakrishna had given up priestly duties, scarcely had 2 years elapsed since Ramakumar's passing away, Sri Ramakrishna's elder brother's passing away, and his brother Rameshwar came to know, to their utter dismay, that Sri Ramakrishna was suffering from insanity. Misfortunes never come singly. One after another, mishaps come on all sides and darken a man's life completely. This was exactly what happened to them. Gadadhar, whom Chandra Devi had borne in her advanced age, as we all know, was naturally very dear to her. Overwhelmed, therefore, with sorrow, she made arrangements for bringing back her son to home. When he was with her, she noticed his difference, absent-mindedness and restlessness, heard his repeated and piteous cries of mother, mother, and tried various means to remedy them. Along with administering medicines, various rites propitiatory to gods and demigods were tried. This was at the end in the year of 1858. Although after his return home, the master generally lived his normal life, he became sometimes overwhelmed with spiritual emotions when his deportment and behavior became quite contrary to the normal. Again, he felt great pain on account of the burning sensation of his body. Thus, on the one hand, he displayed his usual simple and amiable behavior towards all, his devotion to God and mother, and his love for his friends. And on the other hand, there were evident in him from time to time an extraordinary contrary manifestation of an indifference to everything, an absence of shame, aversion and fear, an exuberant eagerness for attaining a vague unknown object, and an obstinate effort to clear all obstacles from the path to his desired goal. These produced in the minds of people a strange belief that he was possessed by a ghost. An exorcist is imitated. That thought had crossed the mind of the simple hearted Chandra Devi also. Now, when she heard others talking about in the same strain, she resolved to call an exorcist for the good of her son. The master used to say, one day an exorcist came, burnt a wick sanctified by mantras and made me smell it. He said, if it is a ghost, it will flee. That exorcist said, you smell this one, this wick, and if there is a ghost, the smell will die out. But it was of no avail. So no devil ran out. That means there was no devil at all to run. Afterwards, worship and other ceremonies were also performed with the help of a few famous exorcists and a chanda. Chanda is another one. Ghost was invoked. The chanda accepted the worship and offerings, became pleased and said to the exorcist, neither has he been possessed by a ghost, nor is he suffering from any disease. The chanda then addressed me, Sri Ramakrishna, chanda then addressed me in the presence of all and said, O Gadai, you want to be a sadhu, a monk. Why then do you take so much of betel nut? Don't you know that it increases lust? Indeed, I liked betel nut very much and used to take it very often. However, I gave it up at the chanda's word. The opinion of the master's relatives. Then the master was about to complete his 23rd year. To a great extent, he regained the normal state of his health during his stay at Kamarupa. There must have been some particular reason for his regaining his normal health and the ceasing of his piteous crying. That he could now be at peace was surely due to the repeated visions of the Divine Mother. We are firmly convinced of it from what we have heard about his state at that time from his relatives. We shall now narrate the relatives' account. All alone, he spent a good part of his time in the two fearful solitary crematoriums named Bhutirkal and Budhimoral. So Budhimoral and Bhutirkal, these were the two crematoriums. They were very much feared by people naturally. So he used to go, Sri Ramakrishna used to go and meditate there. Now his relatives came to know of the occasional manifestation of extraordinary powers in him. The master, we are told, went out from home with a pot full of sweets and other eatables in order to offer them to the jackals. Jackals are supposed to be the vehicles of Kali and vehicles of the mother goddesses. So the jackals he wanted to feed with the sweets, etc. And the demigod that lived there. When those eatables were offered as oblation to them, the pot, the master told them, would go up in the air and vanish into the void. And he would sometimes see those demigods with his own eyes. When his second brother, Rameshwar, found that he did not return home, even after midnight, he would go towards those two places and loudly call his brother by name. The master would hear him and reply in a loud voice, yes, brother, I am coming. Don't proceed further. This side, the demigod might harm you. During this period, the master planted a seedling of Vilwa tree with his own hand in the Bhutirkal crematorium. He used to sit under the old people tree and was there and meditate and perform japa for long periods of time. From what the relatives of the master told us, it appears that the painful want that he had been experiencing, the want of the vision of the Divine Mother, was now removed by some extraordinary spiritual visions and experiences. When we study this period of his life, it seems to us that he was now having constant visions of the Divine Mother's form, their mother extremely gracious to the sadhakas, the people who practice the spiritual practices, consisting of pure consciousness, holding in two of her hands a sword and a severed head, and stretching out the other two hands in gestures of boons and absolute fearlessness. He was now molding his life according to her directions received in response to his questions. He had, it seems, the firm conviction since then that he would soon have the unique fortune of having the Divine Mother's continual beatific vision. He was having it never then. Now he wanted to have it continually. An instance of the Master's yogic powers. We have heard not only of the Master's being engaged in such rites and ceremonies as feeding jackals and demigods, but also of his practicing yoga, as a result of which he developed prophetic powers. Hriday and many people of Kamarpuku and Gairangoti attested to it, and we heard the same from the Master himself. On finding him normal, the Master's relatives decided to get him married. By now, the Master's mother and other members of the household had learned that, by the grace of Providence, the disease which he was suffering from had abated to a great extent, for they noticed that he did not now cry piteously as before, and took food at the proper time, and that all his other actions and behavior were just like those of ordinary persons. But the fact that he used to go very often to the burning grounds and sit for worship and meditation, putting off his cloth without any sense of shame, and that he would get annoyed at the interference with his prayer and meditation, and spend most of his time with gods and goddesses, to the utter disregard of others' words, all these were to be regarded as his natural inclinations from his childhood, and not as something unusual due to insanity. They saw with great apprehension that the Master was completely indifferent to worldly affairs, and that there was an uninterrupted inwardness about his personality. The fear that there was a great possibility of a relapse as long as he did not pay attention to the daily worldly concerns in a natural way and did not give up his indifference arose in their minds. And over again, and through them even now, into a gulf of anxiety. The Master's affectionate mother and elder brother were now very often busy on inventing various means of saving him from a relapse into that state. At last, after a good deal of thinking and consultation, the mother and the son decided to get the Master married, and therefore an urgency was felt for finding a suitable bride, for they thought that the Master's mind would not roam about in high spiritual regions if he began to love a good-natured wife coming of a noble family. Although he was now in the prime of his youth, he was dependent in all respects on his mother and brother, and was the same guileless boy as ever. The slightest effort or endeavor for improving his own worldly affairs was not perceptible in him. How could it be forthcoming unless the responsibility of maintaining his wife and children rested on his shoulders. That is how the mother and his brother thought. The bride had to be brought into the bridegroom's family only after paying a marriage portion according to the custom of that part, some amount of money. Had they the means to pay such a money as the marriage portion of a girl of 10 or 11 would require, they hesitated and had not married off Gadadhar till then. They didn't have enough money to pay for a 10 or 11 year old girl. So only because money could not be gathered on account of various mishaps in the family. Had he been married long before to a girl of 5, she would have grown up by this time to attract her husband's mind and could have taken upon herself much of the management of the family also. In any case, what was destined to happen had happened. There should be no more delay. So they sought for a bride all round. Very vigorously they started searching for a bride. The reason why the master consented to marry. However, secretly, the consultation between the mother and the elder son took place. The clever master came to know of it very soon, but he did not raise any objection, but consented when the proposal of marriage was made. Rather, he behaved like a child who makes merry and feels happy on festive occasions in the family. Was it because he got an affirmative reply to his question from the Divine Mother, the Mother Universal, that he was in such a mood or merriment? Or was it due to his boyish lack of thinking or foresight? No doubt, people in general would point out the latter as the reason. But we have discussed the topic elsewhere and have reasons to differ. The master selected his bride. People were sent on errands to the surrounding villages, but nowhere could a suitable bride be found. Rameshwar, the elder brother of the master, did not venture to settle the marriage with any one of the few available girls because their parents demanded a marriage portion too high for him to pay. His friends of the village also did not advise him to settle the marriage by paying such a large sum. Chandra Devi, however, became very anxious, for she was going to get Gadadhar married for his future good and not just for removing her own mental depression into which she was thrown at the death of her godlike husband and of her first son, Ram Kumar, by participating in the unalloyed joy of her pet Gada's marriage. Therefore, she could not rest satisfied with merely thinking that a bride was not available. She could not take that fact. A vigorous search was again made. As no bride was available, in spite of the search, the master's mother and brother became extremely worried when one day the master suddenly went into Bhava Samadhi, spiritual ecstasy, and said, "It is useless to search here and there. Go and search in the family of Ramchandra Mukhopadhyaya of the village of Jairambati. The bride has been marked with a straw and kept reserved there." Marking with a straw, some vegetables, growers, they want to give the first vegetable to some temple or holy man. So they mark up, when the first fruit appears, they mark it with a straw so that nobody else will take it away, or themselves by mistake, they will not utilize for themselves. First part will go to God or a saintly person. So following that custom. So Sri Ramakrishna is remarking, my bride has been marked with a straw. That means she is ready for me to be given as my wife. So go on search in Jairambati village in the family of Ramchandra Mukhopadhyay and kept reserved there the marriage. Although they could not immediately have faith in those words of the master, because some of them thought even then that he was insane. So insane man's word, nobody would believe 100%. So they would not immediately have faith in those words. His mother and brother sent a man there to make an enquiry. He brought the news that, other things apart, the bride-to-be was too young, just a little more than 5 years. As no other bride was available anywhere else, and this girl was found in such an unexpected way, the master's mother had no alternative but to agree to Gadadhar's marriage with that girl. Everything was settled by a few days negotiation. Afterwards, an auspicious day, moment, day and moment were looked up in the almanac. Then Rameshwar went with his brother to the village of Jairambati, 4 miles west of Kamarkapu. Even now, when we go, it's about 6 kilometers, 4 miles, and had the auspicious marriage ceremony performed with the 5-year-old girl, the only daughter of Ramchandra Mukhopadhyay. At that time, she was the only daughter. Later on, he had so many male children, four or five of them, and returned home. A marriage portion of 300 rupees had to be paid. It was the month of May 1859. The master had reached his 24th year. The conduct of Chandramani and the master after the marriage. Chandramani, it is evident, free from anxiety to a great extent after Gadadhar's marriage. When she found that her son obeyed all her injunctions regarding marriage as well as those regarding other matters, she thought that providence was now propitious after all. For would all things have come to pass so well had he not been favorable? The listless son had returned home, a bride of noble descent had graced her family, want of money had also been removed providentially, and Gadai had entered the life of the world. So how could it be said that providence was not favorable? Therefore, the virtuous, simple-hearted Chandra Devi became somewhat happy now. But she, we can clearly understand, became greatly distressed at the thought of the poverty of her family. A few days afterwards, in order to please the bride's father and to keep up appearances, the bridal ornaments had been borrowed from the zamindars of the place, the Lahas, their landlord friends, to adorn the bride with on the day of the wedding. From the marriage day, Chandra Devi, by lavishing her love on the bride, made her new daughter-in-law more than her own daughter, so that Gadadhar also might love her very dearly. Now that the time of returning those ornaments had come, the eyes of the old lady were filled with tears to think that she should muster the sternness to take all the ornaments from the girl's person. She, however, did not express the anguish of her heart to anyone. But it did not take long for Gadadhar to understand it. He pacified his mother with a few words and took off the ornament from the person of his sleeping wife so deftly that she could not know it at all. The ornaments were immediately sent back to the Lahas, but the matter did not end there. The intelligent girl, she was only 5 years plus some months, when she woke up said, "Where are those ornaments I had worn?" With tears, Chandradevi took the girl on her lap and said by way of consoling her, "My child, Gadadhar will give you afterwards many ornaments better than those." The bride's uncle came that day to see her, and when he came to know this, he expressed great displeasure and took her away. Chandradevi was once more rudely shocked, but very soon the master removed that pain of hers by his playfulness and jocular remarks, and such as, "Let them say or do whatever they like. The marriage cannot be another love." So this is how he joked at what had happened. The master returned to Calcutta. After his marriage, the master spent about 1 year and 7 months at Kamarkoottam. His mother had him with her after a long time and did not easily give him permission to return to Calcutta. She did not soon allow him to return lest he should have a relapse of that insanity. Anyway, he stayed on and, according to the custom of the family, went to his father-in-law's house for a few days and returned on an auspicious day to Kamarkoottam together with his wife, who by now had reached her 7th year. Now he resolved to Calcutta shortly after his coming in a pair, as it was called, coming along with the bride. But for his poverty, he would not have, but for his property, poverty, he would not have had to come to Calcutta, because he was earning something and he was supporting himself. He was not a burden on the poor family at the village. Therefore, he came back to Calcutta. Although his mother and brother asked him to remain at home for some time more, the poverty in the family was not unknown to him. How then could the affectionate and loving heart of the master remain free from anxiety, fully knowing as he did all that? He did not comply with their wish, but returned to Calcutta, to the Kali temple, and took over charge of the Divine Mother's service. Scarcely had he performed the worship for a few days when he became so much absorbed in it that everything about Kamarkoottam, mother, brother, wife, worldly affairs, want, etc., got shut up in a dark, secluded corner of his heart. The only idea that occupied the whole of his mind was now how he could see the Divine Mother in all beings at all times. His chest became reddish again on account of continuous japa, remembrance of God, and reflection and meditation on Him. The world and all talks thereof appeared him as deadly poison. That terrible burning sensation came on him again, and sleep vanished, as it were, into the air. But as he had experienced such physical and mental states once before, he was not completely overwhelmed by them as before. We were told by Hriday that on a call from Mathur Babu, Ganga Prasad, the reputed Ayurvedic physician of Calcutta, prescribed for the master medicines like Chaturmukha pills and Madhyamanarayana and other oils one after another for the cure of his sleeplessness, excess of humor of wind, the burning sensation in his body, etc. Although no immediate result was produced by the treatment, Hriday did not lose hope and occasionally went with the master to Calcutta house of the physician for his treatment. One day the master said, when he went there with Hriday, Ganga Prasad examined him carefully and prescribed new medicines. Then there was with him another physician of Eastern Bengal, now what is called Bangladesh. Attracted by the master's looks and thinking deeply over his disease, he said, "It appears from the symptoms that he is in a state of divine inebriation. It is not curable by medicine." The Ayurvedic physician is telling it. It is a divine inebriation, so it is not any disease at all. How can any medicine be prescribed? The master used to say that it was this physician from Bangladesh who of all was the first to be able to ascertain the real cause of his physical changes appearing like a disease. But nobody then believed in his words. Time passed on. Thus, Mathur Babu and other friends and well-wishers of the master grew more anxious and went on trying various treatments for his extraordinary disease. But the disease was on the increase and showed no signs of abatement. Chandradevi's prayopavesana. Prayopavesana, she wanted to give up her life by fasting or doing some austerities. Gradually the news reached Kamakutu. Having no other alternative, Chandradevi undertook a complete fast and death before Shiva for the recovery of her son. Knowing that the ancient Shiva of Kamakutu was an awakened deity, she went to his temple and lay prostrate without food or drink. Here she got the instruction from the ancient Shiva that she would have her desire fulfilled if she undertook that vow in the temple of Shiva of Mukundapur, where she went and undertook the fast again. Although she knew that nobody used to undertake such fast in the temple before, the old lady had full faith in the divine instruction and undertook the fast. Hardly had 2 or 3 days passed when she dreamt that Shiva, the great god, more silvery in complexion than silver itself, bedecked with glowing matted hair and clad in a tiger skin, appeared before her and consoled her, saying, "Don't be afraid, your son is not mad. He is in that state on account of a tremendous awakening of the divine spirit in him." Thus assured, through divine intimation, the virtuous old lady offered worship to the great god with her heart purified by devotion, and returning home began to serve Sheetala and Raghuveer with undivided attention for her son's mental peace. Many men and women, we were told, have since then been undertaking fast in the temple of Shiva at Mukundapur and getting their desire fulfilled. You see, this is a story of faith, whether it is Chandramani, whether it is her elder son, Ram Kumar, or the next son, Rameshwar, or Sri Ramakrishna himself. Their whole life is full of such tremendous burning faith in God, that spirit behind the whole universe. All of them have imbibed that burning faith in Sri Ramakrishna. It was so bright, he would say, even the leaf of a tree cannot quiver, which we say it is quivering out of the wind. So Sri Ramakrishna said, "No, it is by the will of God the leaves are also quivering. Even a leaf on a tree cannot quiver without the will of God." So So they used to be aware of a universal God entering everything, every being, and pervading and entering inside and outside, pervading the whole universe. So they were aware of that one. That was the cause of the tremendous faith, and they put it to use. She just goes there and fasts, and the Lord Himself tells her the real fact about Sri Ram Krishna, which all the intelligent people in Calcutta were unable to do. So we see such incidents, many more, in the coming reading. Today we shall stop here itself. Niranjanam Nityam Anantarupam Bhaktanukampadhita Vigraham Vai Nishavataram Paramesha Nityam Nam Rama Krishnam Shirasa Namaha. O Ram Krishna, the Taintless One, the Eternal One, the One with Infinite Forms, the One who has assumed form out of compassion to the devotees, the Incarnate Supreme Soul and the Adorable Lord of all, we salute, bowing our heads to Thee. Amen.